If you need a certificate, okay, for the assistance, you need to sign here. There is a list here you have to sign, and then you have to scan the code, and then you get your certificate, okay? And yeah, okay, it is, we have today Miguel Camblor. It is a pleasure to introduce you, Miguel. I mean, most of you know him, and if not, I will tell you some of his, pieces of his long career. Well, not so long. In the middle of your career, you are. So Miguel got the PhD here in the Autonoma some time ago, okay? And working on the CSIC, okay? In the Institute of Catalysis and later on the Institute for Chemical Technology. And then he got the Fulbright. His supervisor was Professor Pérez Pariente. And he got the Fulbright postdoctoral fellow, and he was in Caltech for
2 years
there. And then he came back, he got a permanent position in the CSIC, and well, now he's a research professor since some years ago already. And I mean, his main scientific interest are the discovery of new zeolite structures. He got quite a few in discovered, or yeah.
Just a few.
We will learn some of them today. And of course, the characterization and exploration of the possible uses. Okay, and in summary, Miguel, this is a joke. And of course, Miguel plays sax here for pleasure and for you to enjoy. And I think, it's a pleasure to have him here today. And let's discover what he has discovered recently. Okay, go ahead, Miguel.
Ya lo roto. Thank you, Álvaro. And thank you, everyone, for coming. What is this? They told me it was prepared. No. This one. Yeah, this one. Thank you, everyone, for coming. I want to present you some of our latest works that were published in very highly ranked journals. This one in Science, this one in Science, this one in Nature. I know that Dora requests us not to emphasize the impact factor of the journal, but could you guys blame me? I don't think so, right? The work is on a family of stable silica-based zeolites with three-dimensional system of stellar spores. In order to put this in a broader context, I need to give you a primer on zeolites. Many of you know what zeolites are, but this kind of zeolites 101 is necessary, I think. Zeolites are microporous crystalline materials of the tectosilicate type, which means that the basic building unit is a silicon tetrahedron, or a tetrahedron that shares the four vertices with neighboring tetrahedra, making a three-dimensional framework that has pores or cavities. To its zeolite framework that the International Zeolite Association recognizes as valid, this association assigns a three-letter code like this one, FAU, which is a topology independent of composition, symmetry, unit cell dimensions, or whatever. It's only related to the topology in which the tetrahedra are connected to each other. This one here contains a three-dimensional system of large spores, and I will define later what does this mean. If the tetrahedra are all silica, the stoichiometry is that one, silicon O2, and the framework is neutral. But you can have up to half of this tetrahedra substituted by aluminum tetrahedra. Since aluminum has a lower oxidation state than silicon, then a charge arises associated to its aluminum tetrahedra, and this requires a cation to balance this negative charge. Since the these cations are typically in the pores, this means that they have a high mobility and can be exchanged by other cations in the surrounding media. So up to now we have two important properties of zeolites, one porosity, another one charge cation exchange capacity. But if you substitute, if you exchange all the cations by protons, then you have a solid acid that can catalyze reactions with the characteristic that the reactions occur only inside the zeolite, ideally. And this means there is a shape selectivity associated to this pore structure, meaning that not all the molecules will be able to enter the pores and react. Not all the transition states could be formed and give products. Not all of the products that can be formed can diffuse out of the zeolite. This is what we call shape selectivity in catalysis. When you have changed half of the silicon atoms by aluminum in this framework, you have a material with this composition, and this is what happened in a natural mineral called faujasite, from which the three-letter code Fau arises. So now we can see that zeolites can be natural, a phosphonium, but can be also synthetic. Actually, there are more synthetic zeolites than natural zeolites. They have diverse structures. There are up to around 250 zeolite framework types or topologies. They can have very diverse compositions. Not only you can change silicon by aluminum, you can change silicon by titanium, and then you have an oxidation catalyst. So you combining diverse structures and diverse compositions, you have diverse properties. And this gives zeolites a very wide range of applications. Actually, you maybe not know that, but you have zeolites at home, pretty certainly. For instance, in double glazed windows, you will have noticed that there is a metal profile. This metal profile contains below it a dehydrated zeolite with the intention of lowering the humidity inside the window so much that the dew point is not reached, no matter how low the temperature drops. Because if the dew point is reached, then water condenses inside and you cannot clean this in any way. Similarly, in pneumatic brake systems of heavy machines, trucks, trains, etc., dehydrated zeolites are used to avoid condensation because, in this case, condensation can cause the brake system to malfunction. Very likely, you have what the so-called ecological detergents at home, in which zeolites can be as much as over, actually more than 30% by weight. Here, the zeolites are used as builders, substituting for phosphates. Builders in detergents are materials that are able to remove calcium and magnesium, then allowing foams to form. Phosphates cause eutrophization of the water, so zeolites are used as an ecological alternative. You may wonder why Tutankhamun is there. It's just because it's beautiful. Of course not. Natural zeolites have been used since centuries. One of the applications was an ornamental use because the blue stripes in the Tutankhamun mask is a semi-precious stone called lapis lazuli, whose main blue component is lazurite, which is a zeolite. This, with this semi-precious stone, a very expensive dye was formed by grinding it, until it was called ultramarine. Until in the 1800s, a French chemist was able to synthesize this material. Now it's a cheap one. You can have niche applications like this. This washing machine with zeolites that promise this is better care of and cleaner and drier than ever. And you can have also a technology to maintain the golf courses based on a technology developed by the NASA for potential stations, extraterrestrial extensions. But the main by far uses of zeolites are on the chemical and petrochemical industries. You may think that this is an ugly picture with a lot of smoke, etc., an ugly plant, but actually zeolites are used in the chemical and petrochemical industries to extract more efficiently the chemicals we need with lower pollution and wastes. Here, zeolites are used both as catalysts and as absorbents for separation and purification processes. You may wonder about the romantic couple and the beer. This is a very interesting application. It's a beer keg that cools itself. You don't need to put this in the fridge. You don't need to mess around with buckles full of ice like we did last Thursday here. You just operate on a mechanism half an hour before drinking time, and then this allows water to evaporate and absorb on a dehydrated zeolite. The enthalpy of vaporization of water is what makes the zeolite cool. You can see here that the size is pretty good, between 5 and 70 liters. With two or three of these 70 liters kegs, we could have done our party last Thursday. Now, in this and in the second presentation, I want to show you some specific kind of applications for sustainability and remediation. First of all, as cation exchangers, zeolites can remove radioactive cesium and strontium from water resulting from nuclear reactor accidents. This was used, for instance, in the Three Mile Island accident of 1979. This beautiful lady is not only beautiful, she's a smart scientist, it's my friend, of course, from the Institute of Catalysis. She, together with Luis Gómez Ortiguela and Joaquín Pérez Pariente, my PhD supervisor, were able to revert this ability of zeolites to trap cations. They modify a natural zeolite to make it a trap for fluoride, specifically for fluoride, which is a cation. And why? Because all along the Rift Valley in Africa, and especially in Ethiopia, there is a problem with fluoride in the water. It has very high levels. You may think that this is good for your health and for your teeth, but this is not true. This is true up to a level, maybe one milligram per liter. Above that level, fluoride causes fluorosis, which is a health condition, pretty hard health condition, affecting the bones and the teeth. So, moreover, they partner with ONG, Amigos de Silva, working in Ethiopia, and with a Spanish company to produce this material in large quantities and to build plants for the treatment of water. They now are heading to India. They are starting processes in India, not for plants like that one, but for domestic use. And I think this is by far much more interesting than anything that I can, and much more important than anything that I can tell you, or anything that I have done actually in my life. Zeolites can also be used to remove pollutants of organic volatile organic compounds. Since these results are from one of my the zeolites I am going to tell you about, I will explain it later. Zeolites have been proposed as solid electrolytes for batteries. This is a Nature paper of 2021. Sorry, Dora. Zeolites can be used as catalyst of highly selective processes like this one. This one of the zeolites that I'm going to talk about is also active in that, so I will explain this later. And zeolites are able to separate molecules, gases that are very difficult to separate by other means. For instance, propane and propene are formed in many processes together. Propane is can be used as a fuel and nothing else. Propene can be used to make other compounds, including propylene oxide here. So it's very important to separate them. Right now, they are separated by a cryogenic distillation with many theoretical plates, which is the language engineers use to say this is very energy intensive process and very costly. With this zeolite, ITQ12, which is one of my zeolites, it's possible to separate propene without recourse to cryogenic processes. I have been talking about pore size. Size matters with zeolites. We define and classify pores according to the number of tetrahedra making the smallest window along the diffusion path, and they can have no pores, like in this case a six-member ring window is not considered a pore. They can be 8-member rings and we call it small. 10-member ring medium. Here you have the approximate openings. And large pores, 12-member rings. And this is what you find in nature. In nature, you don't have any zeolite with extra large pores. But in the lab, you can do some. Anything with more than 12-member rings, we call it extra large. There are also, in addition to true zeolites, there are also interrupted frameworks in which some of the tetrahedra do not share the oxygen with other bonds. In this case, the International Zeolite Association also assigns a code, but preceded by a dash, to make clear that this is an interrupted framework and not a true zeolite. In this case, with interrupted frameworks, there have been so-called extra large pores, but these have two problems. One is of stability. The stability of the zeolite may be reduced by this interruption. And the other one is that the dangling bond of this interrupted framework got normally towards the channel. So this is a 20-member ring, but actually the effective pore aperture is quite lower. Pore dimensionality is also important because if you have the same pore size, but along several dimensions, you have better porosity, better molecular diffusion, and it is also more difficult to block the pores. These are the competitors of the zeolites that I will show you later, because this can be made pure silica by direct processes or by post-synthesis processes, and these are the most open zeolites with a high stability. This is the timeline for extra-large-pore zeolite, starting in 1988 with BPI-5, and you may think that there are many, but actually all the ones that are in black have extra-large pores in only one dimension. The ones in red, they are extra-large pores, but all of them have the dash, they are interrupted frameworks, and additionally, they have a composition, germanosilicates or gallium phosphates, that have a intrinsically low stability. So the materials I'm going to talk about, CO1, CO3, CO5, are the only true zeolites with three-dimensional stellar spores. They are silica-based and very highly stable, as you will see next. These are the three zeolites. CO1 has a density of 1.32. This is half the density of quartz. CO3 has an even lower density. CO5 has an even lower density, almost reaching the density of water. The pores. And now a very few words about zeolites synthesis. What do you need to make a zeolite? You need, obviously, a source of tetrahedra, something to put in the pores, normally a solvent, not necessarily, and a catalyst for the breaking and formation of tetrahedra oxide bonds. This can be hydroxide or fluoride. Now, I want to focus a little bit on this because this is what we call organic structure directing agents, normally ammonium-based, quaternarian ammonium, imidazolium, etc., that are our way to direct the synthesis and to try to discover new zeolites. I mean, if this osda is very large, the pores of the zeolite need to be large to be accommodated inside, so to speak. Of course, you also need heat. Normally, between, say, 80 degrees and 175 degrees, more or less. In the case of CO5, of the zeolites I'm going to talk, this is the only zeolite that has been prepared by a conventional hydrothermal route. But it's conventional with some peculiarities. One is we use this phosphonium cation, tricyclohexyl methyl phosphonium. This is a pretty big cation. I don't think you can make this with sodium. This is the first difference. The second difference is that phosphonium cations are more stable than ammonium cations in the high alkaline hydrothermal conditions at very high temperature. This is not a usual temperature for zeolite synthesis. This implies the overall activation energy of the crystallization of CO1 is pretty high. Once you get it, you can calcine it to 100, 1000 degrees C without damaging the zeolite. The structure solution of zeolites have been a nightmare for many years because they almost never reach crystal sizes large enough to make a single crystal X-ray diffraction. So we have been trying to do it with model building, direct methods from powder diffraction, etc. But in the last 10 to 12, you see this is around 50 nanometers. In the last 10 to 15 years, there has been a tremendous development in electron crystallography based on both hardware and software improvements. Right now, it is possible to collect single crystal data in one crystal in different orientations of the stage, and you can do this in many crystals, and then you can combine all this data, merge it to based on unit cell consistency, and you get something that is like a single crystal diffraction data with a very high degree of completeness. But electron diffraction is very bad in terms of distances. It doesn't correctly provide unit cell dimensions, and this means the bond lengths and angles are pretty wrong. So we then collected data at ALBA and performed Rydberg refinement. And this electron diffraction was very important in this case because the structure of CO1 is one of the most complex zeolites solved so far. It has a unit cell volume of almost 47,000 cubic angstroms, with 21 unique T atoms and 43 unique oxygen atoms in the symmetric unit, one of the most complex solved. Here is the structure. Since it's tetragonal, this and this are the same. Here you can see that CO1 has a three-dimensional system of extra-large spores plus a three-dimensional system of large spores. These are the extra-large spores, and these are the 12, the large spores. You can see that the difference is notable. Along the third dimension, you will also have pores, but they are sinusoidal, so they are not evident in this projection. Yeah, of course. This is the other way around. This is the dream. I mean, this is what we all could do, but nobody has been able to do anything like that, anything similar to that. We have we use oriented trial and error approach. Oriented because of the wealth of knowledge accumulated over decades of CLI synthesis work. So we know what kind of organic structure directing agents we need to use, what concentration we need to use, what other atoms we need to use. So this is the way it works, and nobody has done it in a different way. Because we have this three-dimensional system of extra-large plus three-dimensional system of large spores, we have what we call supercages. Supercages are important because the transition state, they may determine the largest transition state in a reaction, or may determine the maximum size of a complex that you want to encapsulate inside, etc. This is the supercage in zeolite FAU with three entrances through 12 member rings. Our supercages are, this is similar, and these are larger with system member ring here and system member rings here and here. This porosity gives CO1 a record-breaking specific surface area of around 1,000 square meters per gram. You need to compare this not with MOF that have higher specific surface areas but much poorer stability. You need to compare this with specific surface areas of zeolites, which never reach above 650 square meter per gram. So this is really record breaking. Since CO1 is crystallized with aluminum, it has catalytic activity in acid catalyzed reactions. For instance, in the catalytic cracking of heavy oil, is able to convert more of the heavy oil than any competitor. These are the commercial catalysts, I mean, the active components of FCC catalysts. These are FAU zeolites that have been dealuminated to make it more stable. And we get more commodities and fuels than with any other possible competitor. It can be also used for the removal of organic pollutants, like exemplified here by this pretty large dye, Nile red, which is absorbed in CO1 over 40 times more than on USY. We published this in Science on the Christmas Eve of 2021, so this was brought by Santa Claus, and Dora is starting to get a pretty bit angry for emphasizing the well, CO2 and CO3. CO2 was prepared using the same organic structure directing agent, the phosphonium, without aluminum and at a lower crystallization temperature, and CO2 transforms upon heating into something else that we call CO3. the structure well again solved by electron diffraction with similar symmetry in both of them, or same symmetry. CO2 is not a zeolite. CO2 is a chain silicate that you can see here, or that goes towards the slide here. It's a chain silicate that is zeolitic in the sense that it is embedded in the structure of some zeolites, like a polymorph B of zeolite beta. The chain silicate ends in single four rings that contains silanol bonds that make hydrogen bonds with a single four ring of the next chain. So here in this representation, we are omitting the oxygens except the oxygens in the silanols that I mentioned. So the blue atoms are silicon atoms surrounded by four silicon atoms. The black atoms are silicon atoms that are surrounded by three silicon atoms and have a silanol. You can observe this in the 29 silicon NMR, both in the direct irradiation spectra spectrum because of the presence of signals in this region, and especially under cross polarization, in which you transfer the magnetization from the proton to the silicon that is close enough, and this and this demonstrates these are Q3. So, but CO3 is not the same. CO3 in CO3 there is a topotactic condensation from 1D to 3D. This is the first time this has been reported. This means one-dimensional to three-dimensional topotactic condensation means topotactic means that the topology that of the chain doesn't change. What happens is that the single four rings that I mentioned got condensed because with elimination of water. Then you don't longer have any Q3. All is all are Q4, both the black and the blue balls. It's the first time a one-dimensional to three-dimensional topotactic condensation has been shown in zeolites. Two-dimensional to three-dimensional, that means from layer, from a layer material to a zeolite had been reported, but not one-dimensional to three-dimensional. And it's the first time this double four-ring unit has been made with silica without the use of fluoride anions in the synthesis. With the refinement using synchrotron data, the condensation brings about a shrinkage of the unit cell of 17.5%. But the C dimension, which is the along the which the chains are oriented, remain essentially unaltered. High resolution scanning transmission electron microscopy corroborate the structures. This has been obtained by Álvaro Mayoral, which is now a tenure scientist at IMMA. This is for zeolite freaks, like these ones here. CO3 is the sigma expansion of polymorph B of zeolite beta. If we could do the same with polymorph A of zeolite beta, we will have a zeolite with three-dimensional system of stellar spores with chirality. CO3 can be calcined to 1100 degrees C without degradation, submitted to 760 degrees C hydrothermal treatment with 10% water without degradation. And the porosity provides a specific surface area similar or even larger than the one of CO1. These are the pores, 16 member rings along the direction of the change, and 14 member rings in the other directions. We were able to put titanium in CO2, but after condensation, the coordination of this titanium was not good for catalysis, but we show that CO3 can work for the removal of pollutants, like in this case exemplified by the absorption of Nile blue, which is even bigger than Nile red in CO3 compared to beta. This is the application I told you before. This is removal and recovery of volatile organic compounds. Volatile organic compounds are important in many applications. They are used as solvents, for instance, toluene. You don't want this to go to the atmosphere, and you prefer to recover, not only remove it. Here we compare CO3 in red with beta, pure silica beta in black, absorption of toluene, absorption of water. The important thing is here. These are the breakthrough curves. That means you pass the stream containing the volatile organic compound through a bed of zeolite and monitor when the gas is leaving the zeolite, is released from the zeolite. And this, you can see here that CO3 works much better than beta, and that it is little affected by water. Perhaps even more interestingly, to recover the toluene, you need to heat to a lower temperature with CO3 than with beta. We published this in Science again, January 2023. So in this case, the three wise men brought the paper. Andorra. This is the last part of the talk. This is considering that CO2 is a chain silicate with hydrogen bonds between chains. We thought about the possibility of introducing new silicon atoms in between the chains. So we treated, I mean, Huayan Yu here and Ray Gao, that were my students there, did a lot of work to find the proper conditions for this to work. They use dimethyl dichlorosilane and tetramethyl tetracyclosilane, and got two materials that are interrupted frameworks, and which we call CO4A and CO4B. In the process, the OSDA was also released. And when you calcine this one, you get a topotactic condensation to a true zeolite. And this has several things that are interesting. First, it is the first time an interchain expanded reaction has been realized, or reported. Interlayer expanded reactions were known in zeolites. It's also the first real sigma expansion, also for freakies. And you can see here in this representation that you have different types of silicon. Some in red that are always Q4, some in black that are Q3 here and become Q4 here, and some that are either T3. T3 means a silicon atom that is surrounded by three silicon atoms and one organic group, and D2 is a silicon atom surrounded by two silicon atoms and two organic groups. In this process, there is something also interesting. We got this amazing structure. I told you before that you could not make up to CO3, you could not make a double four ring without using fluoride. Here, we didn't make a double four ring, but a triple four ring. This has not been observed in any zeolite of any composition obtained by any way. The difference, of course, between 4A and 4B is that in 4A you have two methyl groups, so the newly introduced silicon atoms can bond both chains but cannot bond between them. In CO4B, because this tetramethyl silane breaks in the acidic conditions used for the reaction, and because they only have one methyl group, they can bond in pairs here and here. And then when you make the CO5, the truly fully connected zeolite, you get something pretty funny, which is pretty funny for a condensation, that is that the structure expands rather than contract. And this is because this unit separating the chains is more elongated than the former ones. The expansion is pretty large, 12 or 7.5% compared to CO4A or CO4B. Again, the structures were solved by continuous rotation electron diffraction. This technique is so powerful that we were able to locate almost all the atoms in CO4A and all the atoms, including the carbon atoms, in CO4B. CO5, same thing. We locate that directly all the atoms in the potential maps. In this case, one of the referees stated something that is maybe the definition of a biased opinion. He said, this work is amazing, but I have been working with zeolites for over 35 years. I am a crystallographer, and I don't believe it. So he provides some explanations. I am not going to enter in details to explain the silicon NMR results in the next picture. These were absolutely crazy from a chemistry point of view. I was able to demonstrate him this, but we also did something else, a Rydberg refinement combining continuous rotation electron diffraction data, neutron powder diffraction data, and synchrotron powder X-ray diffraction data. And this convinced the guy. Now, for CO5, I mean, the 29 silicon mass NMR of this family of zeolites is pretty amazing and give very interesting information. In CO4 A and 4B, there are Q4, there are T3, there are D2, as our structure solution showed, but there are no Q3. And this means the reaction is essentially quantitative, which is pretty amazing. Another referee didn't want to believe that either. But we show here also that in CO5A, there is little enhancement of intensity under cross-polarization, which means there is a low concentration of Q3, some few defects. But more amazingly, there is a Q4 site at minus 98 ppm. If you don't work with zeolites, and pure silica zeolites, you may not know what is that. But this is actually at the position of Q3 or even Q2 rather than Q4. But this is a Q4. And how do we know that? First, because there is no intensity enhancement of this signal under cross-polarization. The NMR referee guy thought this was not enough. So he wanted to have many more experiments with very expensive machines, 600 megahertz NMR machine, etc. All were crappy experiments, because for these experiments you needed a high concentration of hydrogen that you don't have, precisely because we have very little Q3. Only this one head core experiment, this stands for heteronuclear correlation between proton and 29 silicon, this shows that at minus 98 ppm there is no correlation. This means this silicon is not a Q3, it's a Q4. Then Salva Rodriguez Gomez Balestra, which was a Juan de la Cierva postdoc working with me, did an optimization of CO5 at DFT and then calculated the corresponding silicon chemical shifts. The simulated spectrum agrees very well with the experimental one and corroborates our initial assignment of this strange band to the very strange triple four ring that I mentioned before. Is the silicon atoms in the inner ring of the triple four ring. The pores, 20 in one direction, 16 in the other two. Again, for the freakies, zeolite nerds. CO5 is the sigma expansion of CO3 and the double sigma expansion of polymorph B of zeolite beta. Again, the high resolution scanning transmission electron microscopy Gutenberg, Álvaro Mayoral totally agree with our structures and show very neatly the triple four in there. This porosity translates in an amazing specific surface area of over 1,500 square meters per gram. It's a highly stable zeolite. You can calcine up to 1,000 degrees C or do a hydrothermal treatment at 750 degrees C with 10% water. And we were able to put titanium not directly, but through a post-synthesis treatment with silicon tetrachloride. And the resultant material was an active catalyst for this reaction. And I want to explain right now what is this reaction. This is a reaction that only products what you want, propylene oxide and water. You start with cumene, oxidize it in air to cumene hydroperoxide, which is the oxidant, and it needs a catalyst to perform the epoxidation of propene. Since this is pretty large, titanium zeolites normally don't work, and then the commercial material for this process is a mesoporous material, which means much larger pores than zeolites, much larger pores than titanium CO5, and it worked similarly, titanium CO5. And if you take into account the amount of titanium in each catalyst, you can see that the intrinsic activity of titanium CO5 is higher than that of titanium HMS. And we published this in Nature. In Easter, last Easter, it was the Easter Bunny who wrote this paper. And Dora is already very mad, calling the Spanish Science Agency to complain about this emphasis on high impact factor journals. And then very briefly about peer review in GLAM journals. I have normally no problems in other journals, but here it's pretty amazing how referees need more always. Doesn't matter what you provide, they always need more. So you present this and you get this. Including minor revisions, more replicates, introduction and discussion significantly expanded, the last top mounted laser cannon because, please add necessary circular and triangular windows, because reviewer three cells odd-shaped windows. Front wheel shield needs to be removed or tinted red. Please try this alternate approach, a ski instead of a tire. And then the funniest one, a horse hitch. Because this is what we always did. A horse hitch is a rope to tie the horse to the pole. The problem is not only that. I think the papers were more nice and more readable in their original submission. But there is an author inflation, because every time you ask someone to make an experiment, they are going to say, okay, but my friend comes in the author list and my two students too. And a wasting of money, time, and mental energy, especially that one. Now, acknowledgements. These are the harder worker collaborators. Ray is this guy here. He was my PhD candidate until he got his degree from the Autonomous for work done here. He's now at Johns Hopkins University. He's first author of the Nature paper with equal contribution to Huayan, and he's second author of the Science papers with equal contribution with the first one. Huayan Yu is in his third degree PhD work, and as I said, he's second author in the Nature paper. They both work a lot in finding the proper conditions for the synthesis to work. Salva was, I mentioned already, was Juan de la Cierva postdoc working with me at ICMM. He left for the Pablo de Olavide with a talent, kind of talent that they have in Andalusia. And now he's a Ramón y Cajal at the University of Seville. Álvaro Mayoral is now tenure scientist at TIMMA. Dr. Jan Lee was a postdoc at Stockholm University, now is in Nanjing University. And Fei-Yan Chen was in Bembu Medical College and now in Yale University. I also want to acknowledge my group, Nanostructure, hybrid and porous materials, for a very friendly workplace, the Spanish Agency for Funding, my hippie friends from Within Experimental Error, and you all with love. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Miguel, for this night talk about your stellar porous zeolites. So, now, questions for Miguel. Bea, wait. No, you have to be on the phone.
Okay, thank you, Miguel, for the very clear talk. I have two questions. One is a mandatory question about the stability of these materials, because, of course, I don't know how many times you can use one. You have heat it up again after a particular application, or the aging process of these super, in principle, stable structures compared to other ones. And the second one about the mechanism of absorption or catching, trapping of big molecules on this, because, I mean, especially for big molecules, the size seems not to be very compatible with the inner cavities that the size of the cavities you are showing, or at least I didn't understand it correctly. Mm. So if you want to trap big molecules that, like the one you have shown, I will think that basically the molecules get trapped on the surface rather than in the inner cavities.
No.
So they get through. So the mechanism of this absorption or this, do you have an idea?
Let's start with the final one. In the case of CO1, there is actually a cation exchange mechanism. The Nile red is pretty funny because Nile red gets absorbed inside the zeolite, releasing a proton. Okay. Actually, no. Releasing a proton, no. Gets protonated, and then it changes color. So clearly, yeah, for sure. The pores are large enough to absorb these materials, and the process is an absorption that you can monitor by the changing color of the zeolite, because the Nile red becomes protonated and changes color. And this can only happen inside. In the case of CO3, which is not acidic, I think it's a purely absorption process. It's a normally, pure silica zeolites are hydrophobic, and then they absorb organic molecules like these ones. And I have no doubt that this happens inside the zeolite. With regard to the first question about the stability, the process to make these zeolites are pretty complex and pretty expensive. So we don't make many many long studies on this. In my opinion, CO1 and CO3 will have no problems of stability. I haven't showed this here, but we have made calculations of the stability of these zeolites, and it's similar to other zeolites, which are all stable. In the case of CO3, the stability, the calculated stability, was completely off the correlations known in zeolites because of the triple four ring. And I will expect this will not withstand harsh conditions. Okay, and I will expect that aging and use of this material will finally start to break it.
We have another question here, Felipe.
Thanks, Miguel, for the talk. It's amazing work from the structural point of view. I can appreciate all the challenges that you have faced for sure. But I have a question from the synthetic point of view. Maybe I missed it in the talk, but what is the key factor that leads to the formation of this structure? Is this an organic structure directing agent? And if so, why is it different from others?
For CO1, I have said two things that are important for CO1. One is this phosphonium, which is pretty big and very stable compared to ammonium compounds, and the high temperature of the synthesis. I mean, 190 is not a normal temperature for zeolite synthesis, and we have used an organic structure directing agent that favors the formation, that withstand these conditions. Other than that, I cannot say if there is, I don't think there can be any kind of template agents effect, because you have a single OSDA and at least three different super cages. So how can you promote these different cavities with a single molecule, even if there is some conformational flexibility? Sí. In the case of CO2, it's serendipity. And in the case of CO3 and CO4 and CO5, is let's do it.
But you think then that the conditions, regarding temperature, is more important than the interaction with the organic molecule?
No. I don't think is that. I think the interaction with organic molecule is very important. But I also think that if you work at lower temperature, because of the activation energy, overall activation energy being too high, you will not get it.
Okay.
You know that sometimes you use an OSDA and you don't get anything. There are OSDAs that don't work, but maybe they work in other conditions, if they are stable enough.
Thank you.
Sure.
No questions.
Yeah, thanks, Miguel, for the presentation and the work is really impressive. I have a couple of quick questions. First one is regarding the CO1, which, if I remember correctly, you crystallize with aluminium. I wanted to ask, how much is the ratio between tetrahedral or extra framework alumina, or if all the aluminium is inside the framework? And then the second question is regarding the last one, the CO5. When you include the titanium and you test it in the propylene epoxidation, if you have an idea on which is the speciation of the titanium sites, if they are isolated or they are more like forming higher nuclearity ensembles?
I think titanium in CO5, first, is formed in defect sites. Okay, first. Second, it is probably tetra-coordinated, but is what we know that work in catalysis. And the first question, the amount of aluminum. We had, in our work, the silicon to aluminum ratio was around 15, but there has been a more recent work that expanded this, from 15 to 80, silicon to aluminum ratio, more or less.
Thank you.
Any more questions? I have one or a couple, but very quick. So the first one is, how can you possibly name a zeolite CO1, CO2, CO3 after many years of people discovering zeolites? I mean,
because nobody.
Yeah, that is amazing that these names are not kept. I mean, CO1, CO2. My second question is, are people already trying to replicate these zeolites?
Well, the first one has been already replicated with a wider range of silicon to aluminum ratios.
So this
in a paper in where journal of JAX, or it was a JAX, right?
So you have some followers and it's working. So you're okay. So if there are no questions, we thank Miguel again.
Thank you.